di Carry Out by Carlo De Medio, a researcher at University of Roma III. And I am here because I am a collaborator of Antonella Pocia, and unfortunately she cannot. Join us today because she is involved in a teaching activity as visitor teacher at UCL University. So I will introduce this webinar today for her. And I wish to introduce you the Hidden Knife at its member service. Hidden Knife is a network of academics and professionals in the field of e-learning, education, and open education. And the mission of the Hidden Knife is supports networking of individual members of the association, provides a highly effective meeting and communication forum, and is coordinated by its own steering committee, elected by a ballot of NAP members. NAP provide information for members and opportunities for professional actions. It helps members to build up a personal portfolio, including documents, resources, blogs, photos, media, and so on. And it promotes communication, networking, and increase the coherence of Eden as a learning community. And it helps in finding partners within the membership. Here at this slide, you can find the members of the NAP steering committee. And through the Eden website, you can access to the online services provided to the NAP members. And there are lots of benefits to be included in the NAP, belonging to the largest community in open distance and e-learning in Europe, access to Eden's database of institutional individual members and partners. You can delegate up to 30 individuals in the NAP, attending conference with reduced fees, establishing partnership and exploring projects, free access to electronic versions of Eden conference proceedings. You can use also Eden logo as reference on your websites, blogs, electronic correspondence, receiving new news flashes, discounted purchase for Eden publication, and access to the online bulletin board for efficient distribution of information. And there are different challenges from the chair, using social media and organizing events like this one, so webinar, Eden chat, and so on.
Thank you,
Support
Francesca.
professional development, especially
Evening
for
to all.
young researchers
I'm
and
Carlo De
professionals.
Medio, and I
Improve the
work
NAP.
as a researcher at the Department of Education at the University of Roma III. Today, I'm here to talk about user modeling and its application and its problems. I will present an activity developed for the creation of profiles within the Inclusive Memory Project, directed by Professor Antonella Voce. The ultimate goal of the process that I will describe is to get customized museum experience for each user. Or, as we will see, user category, but I really don't like this word category. Personalization of experience passed through the creation of the FA user model. What is a user model? A user model. Sorry, Francesca said to me that there is a problem with the microphone. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Better? Okay. I unplugged the microphone and I use the one inside my PC. So I think I will start from the beginning. I say that the ultimate goal of the process that I will describe is to customize museum experience for each user. So we want to give a personal experience based on a user model. But what is a user model? The personalization of the experience passed through the creation of user model. And the user model is a computer representation of a person modeled through a series of features that characterize his personal data and his needs. By analyzing a model, a platform can take decision and can recommend personalized path inside the museum or personalized information for each work's presence in a museum. Unfortunately, these techniques that we can find in literature have limitation in the museum environment. Why? Because it's very difficult to generate path for each individual user. And the biggest problem is that often the users are at the first experience in the museum, and we have no data about them. So, we try to infer this data with questionnaire, as we will see, but we then try to find classes of user and model and their behavior. So, what is the instrument that can help us in the user modeling? The personas. The personas are detailed description of imaginary people. So are like archetype of user. The personas are created within a given context after the observation of the behavior in real environment of natural person. So we have to analyze a real visitor inside the museum to create a personas. What we are trying to do, as I say, is to create an archetype that have common characteristics in terms of needs. So, as shown in the slide, persona provides a powerful way to communicate behaviors, goals, wants, needs, and frustration. The goal is to construct a particular person, personas, and represent the diversity of the observed motivation. I'm sorry, but I'm a little bit sick, so. We experimented the all our research inside the Tito Rossini exhibition. So now I will present the experience. The Tito Rossini's permanent exhibition is located at the Department of Education, University of Roma Tre. The collection is displayed for all areas of the department, and the Rossini collection was donated to the university by the artist in the 2018. We organize an experience with the students of Antonella Pauce. I'm sorry, but I have some problem with changing the slides. At the beginning, the exhibition, sorry, but I click and change two times the slides. At the beginning, the exhibition did not provide cultural mediation tools, except for small labels containing basic information like author's name, painting names, and date of production. An activity was organized to try to increase the visitors' interest in the works in the department that were often ignored. Five different works of art were selected by students who participated in experimentalism, museum, and reading modules. For this work, the students had to provide multimedia content and, above all, a creative story written after following a 6-month university module on narrating the museum based on the digital storytelling technique. Heterogeneous and multimodal mediation tools have been created for the exhibition to allow multiple and personalization visits. Why we have chosen this methodology? Because collaborative and creative writing combines with the critical analysis of the literary text and the use of the figurative works of art. Furthermore, the discourse among colleagues during a collaborative writing activity expose visitors to peer thinking process. Understanding that there are different ways to face a situation in their real life, and they can learn to reconcile different points of view and perspectives. Those two points are central components of the critical thinking that is often associated with the visual thinking. Watching and enjoying a work of art, comparing different works of art, artists, styles, and trends. Those activities allows the public to develop their own thinking analysis and evaluation skills, and it's really important. The 6-month university module was a blended learning course in educational research methodology based at the Department of Education, as I say, dedicated to pre-service teachers. Various techniques has been represented for the improvement of museum experience, among which the most important is the digital storytelling. Students were invited to analytical and assessment skills through the analysis of three stories written by different authors based on the works of Tito Rossini. The techniques allow the use of the critical thinking skills to generate stories starting from a work, reproducing the memorization process most commonly used by people. It also allows visitors to actively contribute to the development of the museum by seeing their contents like stories or audio or message published in the public museum, After all, a little review. User were asked to produce the following materials: a description of the work of art from the point of view of art history, then a technical commentary referring to the production of the work. Second, an audio description of the work that we linked to a QR code. Also, a story recited and recorded in a QR code. And finally, a musical track that they think is the better to associate to their story. So we produce an HTML5 page with all those materials for each works, and we create a single QR code with all this information inside. And the aim of the research is to recommend the best QR code for each class of user or personas, as we say before. Therefore, the main objective of the experimentation was to evaluate the usefulness of the additional contents that the students produced, insert through the use of the QR code, and above, to analyze the visitors to recognize some personas for the future and develop of the adaptive path. The sample analysis consists of 15 students from the Department of Education, 13 female and 2 males, average age 36, and participants attend a lesson with a module name, Teaching Methods and Digital Tools in Museum Heritage Education. And they start with a pretest. We organize this pretest to get some information about the user that are at the first visit in a museum, because as I said in the first slide, it's almost impossible to recommend something to people that you know don't know after all. After attending a lecture, so students fill up the pretest and save the personal data in a database, among their stylistic preference on the work. The questionnaires was organized to be anonymous, and each student is associated with a code that we generate using an algorithm. Let's say the code is made by the initials of your mother's name and surname, followed by the last 2 digits of your year of birth, followed by the initial of your parental grandfather, and the 2 digits of your birth of mom. The visit was left free so as not to affect the visitor experience. The only clue that we provide to them is to use the mobile device on the QR code. So, because we fear that maybe if they didn't give this clue, they can go over the works with the QR code and we can't collect data. The students visit the Tito Rossini Experience and fill the second questionnaire, the post-test, in which they are invited to express their preference on painting and mediation tools. Participants reported contrasting opinion regarding the exhibition. Generally, participants reported general interest for the exhibition and appreciate the multimodality mode. So they like the audio and the music associated to the works. Some correlation among users' preference are be found, and we identify some personal traits and some fruition styles for our persona. The participants group was composed by people with a master's degree for the 46.7% and a bachelor degree for the 15.3%. Almost half of them are professional in the field of the cultural heritage, and the 14% are students in the same field. So we can say that the sample was made by industry experts, and we exclude noise in the data caused by the lack of knowledge of the visitors, and that's very important for us. In the following competency table, it was shown that in our sample, it is possible to detect a tendency between either extroversion and preference for realistic art. For instance, then out of 15 participants who prefer realistic Mona Lisa, and the realistic Mona Lisa is one of the questions of the pretest, we ask the students to choose between three versions of the Mona Lisa, one realistic, one Lego-like the game, so a Mona Lisa made by Lego, and a modern Mona Lisa, we can say, and we find this correlation between students that prefer the realistic Mona Lisa and the fact that they are quiet or very extrovert. On the other hand, low extroversion seems to be more related with a romantic art and contemporary art. In addition, we explore the possible relation between extroversion dimension and the preference for a specific fruition modality. Two people with either extroversion tend to prefer the visit of the exhibition without the support of the multimedia technologies, such as audio description of the painting, short stories, or music track. On the other hand, people with lower level of extroversion seems to prefer multimodality. More specifically, they appreciate combining the fruition of the painting while where they are listening a story or a narration. After all, almost all the visitors didn't like the music associated to the painting, and this can be caused by the fact that the music is influenced by the styles, and the people who choose the music have probably different good styles of music in mind, so we can't find a reason for this data. The final analysis of this data led us to identification of five personas, and we create five paths for this kind of personas. First, we identify young people. They are interested in interactive contents, video, music, and for them, they prepare the pages for the QR code with many digital contents and less text. Second, we identify visitors with special needs, visual impairment, physical or mental impairments, and for them we try to produce a path that they can physically done because they can do stairs. And for mental imparities, we organize contents like child, we can say. So simple contents like video and only a story about the works, not a long description with technical language. Third, we identify visitors with linguistics or cultural barriers, like people that cannot read very well, or people that cannot speak the language Italian or English very well. And for them, we try to create pages with images and with simple language explanation of the words. And finally, we find the last two personas that are adult men and adult women, that they look at different kind of art. And we prepare two different paths, one in the Villa Giulia Etruscan Museum that is focused on the war and how the past, the war changed the world, and the second path for the women is focused on the role of the woman in all the society. So from the Etruscan passed through Greece and arrived to the modern time. For each of these people, we prepare a path that, as I said, and the next step for our research is to experiment with the web app, the adaptive path inside a real museum experience, because we use our department to generate the personas, but now we want to know how they perform in a real life experience. I think that we have time to speak about something else. I would also like to mention a second project that we experienced 2 days ago in our department. In this case, we use the same collection of this work, but we applied gamification and augmented reality techniques to increase visitor satisfaction and stimulate their critical thinking skills. It was developed an app for Android device. We choose Android because all the plugins are open source, and in future we think we will develop the app for iOS 2. And this app is a treasure hunt. We call treasure hunt in the museum. Visitors are asked to install the app and read the instructions on the first start. Simple instruction. A visit was then organized through 5 previously selected works. By farming the picture with the camera on the device, the user received information from the virtual 3D model, Mila, we call the virtual assistant, that asked them a series of questions for each work. And these questions are useful for stimulating the critical thinking. For each question in the main menu of the app, a part of a final question will appear. When they finally answer all the 5 questions, they can read the last question, and they can finally get the prize, the final message of the app, and we collect today or yesterday. I'm talking about that with Francesca before this webinar, and the students are really, really engaging and appreciate the style of visit. So in future we will try to merge these two kind of approach, maybe changing the use of the QR code with the augmented reality that seems to get more engaging the visitors. So I think I finish my presentation. Thank you for the attention, and if you have any question, you can ask me and I will answer you. Thank you. Sorry, but as I say, I'm a little bit sick. Thank you, Maria Rosaria.
Thank you, Carlo, for your presentation. It's very interesting as you presented a lot of projects. If there are any questions, we can start to reflect upon them, or maybe we can also continue the conversation during the web hidden chat of this day. There is a question from Maria Rosaria to Carlo.
It's a way to go over the limits of the lack of data. So personas are archetype of user and are really useful in this kind of modeling, because when a visitors enter a museum, we don't know anything about it, his, and we want to recommend something to him. So using a simple questionnaire, like we have done in our experience, we can give a first path to visitors using a persona that is a container of needs. So the questionnaire is produced for recognize these needs and select the right path. After, the artificial intelligence behind the app will recognize the real needs of the visitors and change the class of user. So it's possible that at my first visit I am see like a young guy, and the second time the app, after observe me in my first visit, recognize that I would prefer the world path, like an adult man, or maybe I'm more near the women ideas, so I can be redirected to the women path. But the personas is only a name to call an old concept in informatics that is the archetype of user. This, I think it's okay. If you need some other information, you can ask me in chat. Thank you, Maria Rosaria. As Francesca said, if there are not any questions, we can follow, we can go on with this conversation in the Eden chat tonight. I will prepare five questions, and we can talk about these questions all together. Remember to search the hashtag Hidden Chat tonight. Hope to see you all in the Hidden Chat tonight. Sure. Thank you all. Oh, sure. I will sign up right now. Thank you all.